Hello everyone. Objective of learning this particular chapter is we are going to learn what is function overloading, what are the different advantages and disadvantages of function overloading, and we are going to have one programming example for this as well. Also, we need to look on what is inline function, what are the advantages, what are the restrictions on inline function. And one more objective is we are going to learn about friend function. So, we are going to learn what is friend function, what are the different characteristics of friend function, and we are going to have one programming example for this as well. We know that C++ is an object oriented programming language, and it is the most powerful programming language because of its several features. One of the fantastic features in C++ is polymorphism. Actually, this polymorphism is a word derived from a Greek sentence. Here, poly means more, morphos means forms. We can take different forms. Under polymorphism, there are two categories actually. So, one is operator overloading, in other hand, we will have function overloading. What is operator overloading? For example, there is an operator called as plus. This operator, if it is used with two integer values, we will have addition of these two values. In case these two values are 5 and 5, 5 plus 5 will be 10. So, we will have addition of these two integer values. If the same operator plus, if it is used with two different strings, then the operation becomes concatenation. Suppose the first string is computer and the second string is science. If I place plus symbol between these two words or these two strings, then we will have the concatenation of these two strings. When the output is generated, you will not have the addition, you will have the concatenation of these two strings, then the output will be computer science. See here, same operator plus is used differently. When it is worked with the integer, it becomes an addition. When it used with two string values, it becomes a concatenation. The same symbol used in different forms. This is called as operator overloading. But in our class, we are concentrating on the second part, that is function overloading. We are going to see what is function overloading. To better understand this concept, I will break this into two. The first part is function. We know that when a program is developed, it is not a good idea to write everything in one function called as main. If you write everything in main, it will be very, very difficult for us to understand. The readability will not be in a better position. And it will be very difficult for us to debug the program as well. That's why what we do normally, we will break the whole program into smaller parts or smaller units. These parts or units are called as subprograms or functions. So, what is function then? So, function is a named group of statement developed to complete a certain task for us. This is called as function. Now, what is the second term? The second term is called as overloading. Same function, if it is defined in different way, with a different set of argument, with a different set of argument signature, then it becomes an overloading. Altogether, what is function overloading? So, function overloading is nothing but, or function overloading means two or more function having the same name but differ in number of arguments or type of argument. So, this is called as function overloading. So, what is the need for function overloading? Why do we require this? As I said, the whole program will be divided into smaller units called as functions. If you have several functions of same category, every function, most of the functions are carrying out similar tasks, then it is not a good idea to have different names for each functions. In case if you give different names, it will be difficult for us to remember all the function names. That's why what we do is, we'll give the same name, but will differ in number of argument. So, here the compiler will select the appropriate function depending on the situation, which function to be called. So, we need not to take any call here. Otherwise, we are supposed to call which function to be called. That's why the function overloading concept has arisen. There are some advantages of function overloading as well. As I said, compiler is the responsible to take a call which function to be called. That's why the program executed will be faster. So, that is the main intention of programming actually. So, whenever any program is developed, we need to think of two complexity. We need to reduce two complexity. One is time complexity, another is space complexity. So, here we are reducing the time complexity. The program is executed faster because of this particular concept. And you have divided the program into smaller units called as functions here. Of course, you have applied function overloading concept here. As you have divided into smaller units, the program is developed under function concept or under function overloading concept, the readability of the program increases. That's why you will easily understand the flow of information. Also, it will be very easier for us to debug the program as well. So, that is the second advantage of the function overloading. As debugging is made simpler and made easier, that's why code maintenance is also very easier. And one more advantage here is, it provides an easier interface between the program and the real world problem or real world object. So, these are the different advantages of the function overloading. Every concept has advantages as well as disadvantages. Now, we are going to see what are the disadvantages of the function overloading. As I said, you will have a number of functions, every function you will give the same name, but you have to make a different set of argument list. So, here each function in a set of overloaded function must have different set of argument list. In case if you have not made it different, the function overloading concept may not work. You will get into another problem here. So, that is one of the disadvantage here. Second one is, if typedef is used to naming a function, then the function is not considered as different type. We know what is nothing but typedef is. If one type is there, we can rename the existing data type. For example, there is a type called as integer, we can rename it as number as well. Similarly, if any function is defined, we can rename it using typedef concept. If typedef is used, then the function is not considered as different type. So, these are the different disadvantages of the function overloading. Now, let us understand few examples as well. So, I have considered two examples here, example 1 and example 2. If you see carefully, there are two functions, name of the functions are same. The first example, name of the function is prod, that means I am going to calculate the product, and the second function name is also product. Because in the both the examples, in both the functions, I am going to calculate product, but number of arguments or type of arguments are changed here. In the first example, I have considered three arguments, all the three arguments are of type integer. The second function, if you are giving the same name, either you have to make a change in number of argument or you have to make a change in type of argument. For example, I have done both. For my simplicity, I have done both. Changed number of arguments, I had 3 here. In the second example, I made it 2. In the first example, all the arguments are of type float. In the first example, all the arguments are of type integer. In the second example, all the arguments are of type float. You need not change both here. It is enough to change any one format. Either you need to change the type of argument or you need to change the number of argument. For example, I can in one more function with the same name product or prod, I can have same number of argument, 3 arguments. But data types could be different. Here integer, the first example. Maybe one more example I may take, in that the arguments are integer, float. So, third argument, you could find the difference in third argument. Instead of taking integer, I have considered it as float. So this is how function overloading works. So all the functions will have the same name but differ in number of arguments or types of arguments. So now let us have one program to illustrate this particular concept, this concept of function overloading. We know that what is function overloading? Two or more functions having the same name but differ in number of arguments or type of arguments. When this particular concept will be applied, when similar task we are going to calculate, when we are supposed to have a similar task in the program, when we are supposed to solve a similar task in the program, we are supposed to apply the function overloading. See, in this example or in this particular program example, we are going to calculate volume of different shapes, volume of cube, volume of cone and volume of cylinder. We must know the formula to calculate volume of these shapes as well. Let us analyze this particular program. So we are supposed to calculate volume of a cube. What the cube looks like? It looks like this. We will have different sides. As per cube is concerned, all the sides are equal. I can take it as A. When you calculate volume of cube, the formula is A into A into A, or I can take it as A cube as well. So that is the formula to calculate volume of a cube. Next is volume of a cone. Looks like ice cream cone. But how do you calculate volume of a cone? We have the formula. So what is the formula here to calculate volume of cone? It is 1 by 3 pi r square h. 1 by 3 is a constant. If we calculate, it would be 0.3. And you know that pi is also a constant, mathematical constant. The value of pi is 3.14. So arguments are two here, r and h. R square h, you are supposed to multiply r and r, then you will multiply h as well. So you can see two arguments. In the first example, as per volume of cube is concerned, you will have only one argument. May I take it as integer variable? In the second example, r and h are the arguments, two arguments. I can take r and h are double or float, whatever I need. And there is one more concept to calculate volume of a cylinder. It looks like a Coca-Cola tin, right? So how do you calculate volume of a cylinder? We have the formula, very similar to volume of a cone. So what is the formula here? The formula is pi r square h. We are using only one constant here, that is pi. It's a mathematical constant. The value of pi is 3.14. Again, look at the arguments. Again, here two arguments are used. Look at the previous example. There also we had two arguments. Here also two arguments. But how do you have a change in this? Just change the data type. We can't change the number of arguments, because when you calculate volume of a cone, you need two arguments. When you calculate volume of a cylinder, you must have two arguments. You can't change that. But you can change the data type of it. What can be done? First argument, let me take it as double, as similar to the previous example. The second argument, I will make change. Instead of taking it as float or double, I will make it as integer. See, look at all these. We are calculating a similar operation. So what we are going to calculate? We are going to calculate volume. So every function will have the same name. The name of the function will be volume, but you will have different set of arguments. That is nothing but function overloading. Let us see the programming example. At the beginning of the program, we are supposed to write header part as a pre-processing directive part. So what we do? We will include several header files. We will include header file called as iostream.h. We will have hash include iostream.h. We will have hash include iomanip.h. And we will have hash include conio.h. So these are the header files, which is compulsory to most of the program, because you will be having corresponding functions in our program. That is why it is better to have at least these three header files in the program. After that, I am going to create a function for this. Sorry, I am going to create a class for this. So how do you define the class? The class is defined in this way. You are supposed to write a keyword called as class followed by class name. So here this example is concerned. I will take the class name as function overload, or I can take it as fun overload, right? And I am going to define each and every functions inside this particular class. will be defined under the public section because it has to be accessed by the main program. So, under public section, first I am going to define the function that will calculate volume of a cube. As I said, when you calculate volume of a cube, right? So, what do you need to have? You need to have one argument. So, you can see that you will have only one argument, that is integer. So, when you calculate this, you know the formula to calculate this. The formula to calculate this is a into a into a. So, that should be the body here that has to be written to the calling function. So, this is nothing but called function. We are defining the called function. The name of the function is volume here. So, what we are going to return here? We are going to return a into a into a. So, that is a formula to calculate volume of a cube. Right? Next, I am supposed to calculate volume of a cone. So, how do you define that? So, look at the return type specifier, because you are giving two inputs, two arguments, both the arguments are double. When you calculate volume of cone, when you are having double type of values, definitely the resulting value will be in the form of double, that is the return type specifier is double. Look at the function, same function name I am applying here, the name of the function is volume. So, inside parenthesis you can see the arguments. So, in the first function I had one arguments, in the second function I am taking two arguments. The first argument type is double, second argument type is double. So, both the arguments are of type double. You can see we have changed number of argument as well as type of arguments. So, function overloading meaning is not contravened here. So, what is the formula to calculate volume of a cone? We know that 1 by 3 pi r square h, that has to be written. Okay. We are going to write the body of the function here. So, that is going to return 1 by 3, I am going to write it as 0.33. So, 0.33 into pi value is 3.14 into r into r into h. Because we already analyzed the formula to calculate volume of a cone. So, that formula I am going to apply here. So, that will be returning to the main program or returning to the calling function area. Then volume of cylinder, I need to calculate volume of cylinder. So, I am going to write the function header for that. So, what is the return type specifier here? Once again it is double. Function name similar to the previous one, so that is volume. Look at the arguments. The previous example double and double, now I have changed double and integer. We have two arguments r and h, I will make r as double, h as integer. So, double r int h. So, what is it is going to return? It is going to return pi r square h. So, what is the value of pi here? 3.14 into r into r into h. So, these are the different functions I am going to have defined inside the class. So, I have closed the class as well. Now, I will write the main part, void main. So, how do you write main part? You start with void main, you will begin with void main, then you are supposed to declare an object belonging to this particular class function overload. So, how do you create an object? Class name followed by object name. So, it will be fun overload followed by capital F. So, F is a object here. So, using this object F, I am going to call each and every function. The compiler will decide which function to be called out of these three depending on the argument list. Right? Suppose if you are supposed to call the first function, you must send one argument. So, how do you write that? Of course, clear screen will be written in the program. After that, you write volume of cube is equal to, you call the first function, the name of the function is volume. So, you call like this, object name followed by member operator followed by function name. It will be f dot volume. Inside parenthesis, I write 10 for example. There is a one argument, the type of the argument is integer. So, which match is found, you will call the first function. When the first function is called, you are transferring the flow of control to the called function. At the same time, you are passing the value as well. The value of the actual argument is 10, that is taken by the formal argument there. The name of the formal argument is a. That is taken inside the body of the function, you will calculate a into a into a, 10 into 10 into 10. It will be calculated as 1000, that will be returned back to the calling original calling function. Then it will display volume of cube is equal to 1000. Next, suppose if you are supposed to call the second function, a similar set of statements, your statement I am going to write, volume of cone is equal to, you are calling the same function here, f dot volume, name of the function is same here, but look at the argument, 2.0 and 3.0. So, both are real values. So, which function will be called? Your best suiting function is second function. So, that function will be called and you will have a return of value and you will display the value. And you are calling the third function as well to calculate volume of cylinder and to display the value. So, volume of cylinder is equal to f dot volume, once again name of the function is same, but look at the arguments 2.0, 3. The first is a real value, second is an integer value. So, best match is third function, double and integer. Get CH and you will have the close of program as well. Now, let us see the output part. Okay, for example, when I calculate volume of cube, f dot volume function is called, there is one argument. If you see there, the first function is highlighted here. That means, you are calling that particular function and that returns a value, that is 1000, you will see the output as volume of cube is equal to 1000. Similarly, when the second function is called volume of cone, you are calling f dot volume and arguments are real values 2.0 and 3.0, you can clearly see that second function is activated here. I have highlighted that particular part. Even though the function name is same, you are not calling the first function or third function, you are calling the second function because that is the match here. And then you will have the output volume of cone is equal to whatever the returning value from the second function. Then when volume of cylinder function is called, okay, when you are going to execute volume of cylinder value, C out volume of cylinder, you are calling the volume function f dot volume, you are passing two arguments 2.0 and 3, first is real value and second one is integer value. You can see that the third function is activated here. I have highlighted the third function because that particular function will be called by the compiler, right. So, that particular value will be transferred to the third function 2.0 and 3. It will calculate in the body, the volume will be calculated, that particular value will be returned to the calling function. Then you will see the output as f dot, in the place of f dot volume 2.0, 3, you will see the output. So, volume of cylinder is equal to this much. So, this is how function overloading works. Look at all the three functions. Names are same, but argument lists are different, right. Even if you see the second and third function, the values are very similar, 2.0, 3.0, this next one 2.0 and 3, but look at the type, look at the second argument in each, there we have taken 3.0 and 3. So, this is the change, 3.0 will be considered as real value, 3 is considered as integer value. So, this is how we are going to make a change in this. This concept is nothing but function overloading.